Good morning, good morning. Good afternoon or good evening, depending on when you're listening to me right now. We're going to talk about something. My wife and I just came back from a vacation a few days back. And we ran into some people that were very talented, very gifted. They, from after further investigation and understanding, had been raised in the church and had been doing ministry work in the church, but had to find their success outside of the church, so to speak. I'm not just talking about the church building. I'm talking about outside of the body of believers. These people have been raised in a church environment, and they had been hurt in a lot of ways. I can't honestly say that all of it happened within the church, but I do know that the church contributed to what happened. And now this is the thing we need to talk about right now. I need to ask you a question. But before I ask this question, I'm going to read a scripture to you from the book of Proverbs, Proverbs 18, and verse number 16. Hallelujah. It says, "A man's gift maketh room for him, and bringeth him before great men." Now, that's important for all of us to understand. The gift that God has given you is designed to bring you places. Now, let's deal with this on a basic aspect. Everything that you have as far as giftings and abilities comes from God. Every one of us was created with a purpose. We was born with a purpose in mind. And it is true that a lot of people today live aimless lives and don't have any purpose. There's lots of people that do things just to make money, but it doesn't fulfill the purpose. And the truth, and we can tell because there's lots of people that make money, but still are not happy. Because if they was, they wouldn't have to do drugs. They wouldn't have to go through bouts of depression. There's lots of people that may even be successful in what they do. But if it's not their purpose, they're still going to feel a sense of emptiness. And in particular, those that do things in the secular world and God is not in it. That's important because there's people that do stuff every day that God doesn't have them doing. Sometimes the pressures of life, the opinions and views of others. In other words, there's a lot of people are doing stuff because their parents guide them down a specific pathway. The prevailing trends of the era, drive them down to a specific vocation. They do things because that is supposed to be the way things are done in order to be successful. And they don't have the understanding that God is the one that holds their destiny. And because a lot of people, by and large, don't seek God concerning what their purpose in life is, they end up going aimlessly. Now, I know that to be true because I did that. I know that to be true because I went down a pathway at a time when I was not born again, thinking that that's the way it was supposed to be. Now, that may not be true for everybody, but it was true for me. And I know it's true for a lot of people. People are not fulfilled. It was only when I found my destiny that I started to see fulfillment. And there's challenges even in that. But when you find your destiny and what you was called to do, stuff starts to work right. Now, I'm going to give you this illustration before I go into what I want to talk about. There's been times over the years that the voice that you hear came under a lot of scrutiny. I had people tease me about my voice. When I was, an adolescent, I was teased about it. When I went through basic training, I was teased about it. And even people in the church that I eventually got licensed and ordained, they would mock my voice. They would poke fun at my voice. It's got a little bit of a high pitch to it. But the truth of the matter is, that's what God gave me. I had to learn how to embrace my voice and also the family that I was born in, the color of my skin, I had to learn how to embrace those things because that's God-given. And there's lots of people out there that use what God has gave them. Either they don't value what God's given them, they get mad with God because they was born a certain way, or they take it to the opposite extreme because they was born a certain way, they feel that they're better than everybody else. That's a total disrespect. It was never intended to be this way. This is why people feel superior. You can't take credit for anything that God did. The most you could ever do is embrace what God did and use it for the furtherment of his purpose for you in your life. Hallelujah. That's very important to understand. So you have to turn around and look at yourself a different way. Because if God created you, he created you with a purpose. How he created you, there is a purpose. Now, a lot of people may have a problem with that, but the truth of the matter is, it is what it is. You came here with a design from God to manifest that. And people have used it. People have either disrespected it or they've tried to take it to a level that God never intended it. But that's all. But that's just the way it is. So with that said, how you was created, and particularly for those I'm talking to born again believers now in particular, the gift that God has given you, whatever it is designed to prosper you and bring you into a place where you can start to see fulfillment. And my job is to be a wake-up call for you, is to be simply a voice, to let you know that God has got awesome things for you. Now, getting back to these young men, they are, right now, they're currently playing country music. And on the surface, like I said, people would look at that and just see it, that they're just trying to be successful. But going back to what I said earlier, they was raised in the church. I mean, a couple of them was groomed. Their pastor, their father was a pastor. And the thing was, is that I'm going to deal with something that may not be popular with a lot of people. This is the question I need to ask. Why do people who was raised in church, who was as talented and gifted as these young men are, why do they have to go outside of the church in order to be successful? Why do they have to go outside of the church to even prosper in the giftings that they have? Let me give you a little illustration. There's a prevailing thing today in church where, and particularly with a lot of pastors and a lot of ministers, they feel that people that operate within the realm of music are not doing the type of ministry that validates them being sustained by their giftings. There's lots of people that will play in the church and still have to work a secular job in order to take care of their families. That's tragic. Because the thing about it, and matter of fact, I know of a minister who donated his talents to the church and playing four times. Oh, I mean, playing at four churches on a Sunday and not being compensated like he was supposed to. The devil is a lie. The devil is a lie. Now, help. Now, I'm going to help you understand something. We should do everything as unto the Lord. I understand that principle. Believe me, I understand that. But to disrespect the gifts of God is tragic. The Beyoncés of the world, the Aretha Franklins of the world, the Whitney Houstons of the world. These people are out there in the world, but they was groomed in the church. They was groomed in the church. And a lot of times when it comes to blessing people who are talented and gifted, we primarily look at the preacher. But you got to understand something. If the temptation to go out here in the world and to be validated by the giftings that they have is real. And that's a temptation that people all face. And Many times we criticize people for going to the world, for to be embraced, which is a natural inclination for everybody, but we as the church do not support them. We as a church do not support people who are gifted in music, particularly, and in other areas. And we force, we put them at a place where they have to make a decision between taking care of their families and still serving God with their talents and giftings. Hallelujah. Why should a person in the church have to go to the world to be validated when the church, who's supposed to be the most powerful institution in the world and the one who's supposed to be an example to the world as to how to live life, we're too cheap to bless the people of God in that way. Now, I can understand. Now, there's preachers that are not that are not supported and are not and are not embraced for the giftings that they do. I understand that. But there's lots of people that believe that it's okay to bless the man and woman of God as far as a preacher's concerned. But a person who can sing, a person who can play the piano, they're supposed to donate their time to the Lord and just believe God. The devil is a lie. If your church is big enough to finance people who can type, who can stamp letters and all that stuff, you can also embrace people who are gifted by God as psalmists to be a blessing. Now, one thing I can say about the church that I came out of, the church that I got licensed and ordained in, they believed in taking care of their musicians, the chief musicians. They believed in doing that. Those that was gifted to play, I'll give them, and they did those things. Because if music was not that important, why did God himself have a minister of music? Now, ultimately, Lucifer went to the other side. But at the beginning, God created a minister of music. If music was not important, God wouldn't have done that. So what happens is that we criticize people for leaving the church, for going out there to be embraced, but we don't take the time to embrace them monetarily and also, I mean, give them the respect that's due. Hallelujah. Because the scripture says that a man's gift will make room for him. And a lot of people, if we're too cheap in the church to embrace people, then we put people at a place where they have no choice. We would much rather them go out and work a secular job in the name of the Lord than to go out and do music. Now, I'm not condoning compromise. Hear me. I'm not condoning compromise, but I'm saying we put people out there at a place where the way that they're gifted is, they have to choose. And this is the thing. When a person is being used of God the way they are, they can grow. And this is the thing. Worship is very important. When our worship leaders have the opportunity before the Lord, when they have an opportunity before the Lord to spend time working at what God has gifted them to do, they become better. They become more refined in a lot of ways. Now, I'm not talking about those that are hirelings, those that are going out there and they're following every dollar and it's all about the dollar. I'm talking about true men and women of God that are out, that have been called of God. And this is the thing also too. If we can believe God for the church, we can believe God for the whole running of the church, you should have enough faith to believe that God will be able to take care of the people that are responsible for the primary worship in your services, because you need worship to bring deliverance. You need worship in order to bring deliverance. Hallelujah. You need worship in order to bring the presence of God down. Now, it may be true that in a lot of cases, I mean, you can bring worship in by simply just praising God and worshiping God on a different level with or without music. I understand that. But the truth of the matter is, there are some times where music can be necessary in order to elevate the spirit in the place. And when people are not able to focus on these things, we put them in a place of temptation. Even for us as ministers, those that have to work a secular job in order in order to maintain their family, the devil is like that. That's not biblical, beloved. That's not biblical. Now, it's one thing to do things as a choice, but it's another thing to do some things because you have no choice. The way God set it up, what was, I mean, for the ministers to be able, those that preach of the gospel should be able to live of the gospel. That's, it's the scripture. I did not write that. But the thing about it is that we have to understand that people are put in a position where they have to go out into the world and do the things that should be taken care of by the house of God. It is what it is. Now, Brent and I have a son that does music. And he's starting out as far as putting his stuff out there, sowing seed, and he's giving out CDs. And again, he's given us some CDs to pass out because he wants to sow seed. But for his own personal CD, the one that we have, we sowed a seed into that. We paid for that. Why? Because we believe in embracing people in their gifting. We took the time to pay for ours. That's the bottom line. Because that's what we believe in. And anybody, when we was doing ministry, I mean, particularly in Dallas, because now we're more evangelistical now. When we was pastoring in Dallas, we wouldn't have nobody speak, whether it was a junior minister or anything like that, I mean, young minister or whatever the case is. We never had anybody speak without sowing a seed into them. That's the way it works. Because that's how the kingdom works. We sow seed. When a person labors, they should be compensated. It is what it is. And for those of you that are too cheap to embrace the giftings that are in your church, shame on you. And this is the reason why a lot of things don't work the way that they're supposed to do in a lot of churches. Because we prostitute the gifts of God, we use the gifts of God, and we don't embrace it. Now that does happen with preachers. There's people that'll come in there and people will stick it to them. I've experienced that. And I'm being real this morning. I'm being real. It is what it is. But the truth of the matter is that when you rob people of their opportunity to be used of God, at some point it doesn't go well for you. It does not. Depending on the motivation, it does not go well for you. So we want to take the time, and for those of you out there that are gifted right now, those of you that feel the call of God for music or anything that is not classified real ministry, we want to make sure that if you are being embraced, make sure that you take what belongs to God and give it to Him. It is what it is. Make sure that you sow your seed, and you obey God, and you do what you're supposed to do concerning anything that God blesses you with, and it'll continue to go well for you. It doesn't have anything to do with how big or large the church is. It has everything to do with God. God can take the little bit that you have and cause it to be increased. So don't say that because you're a small ministry or that you've got a limited budget per se. The same way you believe God for your budget, you can believe God to open up some doors for those that are there to help you in ministry as well. It's all the same thing. You can believe God for the whole package. Elevate your faith today. Of course, there's somebody that's not going to agree with what I'm telling you right now. But before you say that you have a problem with what Apostle Young is saying, take the time to pray about it. If God can bless you, God can bless you on whatever level that you want. God is not limited as how He wants to bless you and how He can bless you. I want to encourage you today. If God can make room for your gift, He can also make room for somebody else's gift too. Hallelujah. I speak a blessing over you today in the name of Jesus. We declare God's blessing over this word today. We'll be talking to you again real soon. And we activate destiny and purpose in those that are listening. We'll come to you again in the near future.